I want to say welcome, and I also want to let you all know before I introduce Dr. Hagen that there will be a reception afterward in the President's home, so please do join us for that. Dr. Susan K. Hagen has served on the faculty of the college since 1976. During her time of service, she has served in various positions, including Provost, Associate Dean of the College, Director of the Harrison Honors Program, and Associate Provost. She continues to serve with Phi Beta Kappa nationally. Upon her retirement later this year, Dr. Hagen will be missed by many in the BSC community for her constant willingness to answer the call to leadership as an administrator. But at the center of her impressive career has always been her dedication to students. She has continued to work with students as a professor and mentor, offering courses that span the curriculum from first-year writing to medieval literature. In planning for this evening, I heard from several of her former students, from clergy to journalists, doctors and researchers, a diverse group of former students, all sharing in common Dr. Hagen's formative role in their lives of significance. I have come to think of this group as its own kind of garden, if you will, of students now flourishing all over the world in professions they came to through her encouragement to explore various disciplines in the true spirit of liberal arts and interdisciplinary study. Each of us carries on Dr. Hagen's legacy as we take on a difficult task, measuring up to the high standard of scholarship she demands from students. I also bring her spirit to the page anytime I've written a particularly concise or balanced sentence. Anytime I've pushed for equal representation in language or in life. I also think fondly of Dr. Hagen anytime I've taught a successful lecture, read a moving poem, or when I see a beautiful garden. Though as a sentimental former student of Dr. Hagen's, I'm tempted to quote T.S. Eliot saying, "April is the cruelest month," as I introduced Dr. Hagen for her last lecture. But I know that Chaucer, whose work so many of us have grown to love in the classroom of Dr. Hagen, is the appropriate poet for the occasion. We know from the Canterbury Tales that April is when the best trips and stories begin. And so in Chaucer's April tradition, I'm excited to introduce Dr. Susan K. Hagen to you as she begins her last lecture, marking the beginning of her next exciting journey.
Teach for another 30 years, nearly as many as I have lived so far, twice as many as I have so far taught. And while I would not expect that which I would say 30 years from now to be as different as that which I would have said 30 years ago at the age of 7, that was 37, I do nonetheless trust that in the interim I will grow in wisdom and kindness, in understanding and tolerance, judgment and gentility. Still, left with no other definition of the last lecture and with no more time to finesse the topic, I am brought to the point of offering to you now what must be viewed as tentative testament, or testament in the process of becoming. Take it. Turn it over in your minds. Test it. But do so tenderly, for if no infant, it is still a novice. If not wholly innocent, it is at least part naive. I went on to talk about the importance of the precision of language, of perspective, of what Boethius' 6th century consolation of philosophy has to teach us, and of passion. The capital passion of Christ, capital P, passion of Christ, passion in one's life, passion for being. Nothing has changed, except it's been 33 years instead of 30 years since that first last lecture. I hope I have grown in wisdom and kindness, in understanding and tolerance, in judgment and gentility. Despite the students who have dubbed me Dragon Lady, I'm content. I've also been called the Hague. The Hagosaurus. I even had a picture of that once. I think it was a brontosaurus with my head. I couldn't look at the picture, I wouldn't have used it tonight. Of all of the nicknames, though, I think Professor Minerva McGonagall is probably the one that I appreciate most. I like Max. To the point, though, while what I say today might not be as tentative, it remains, in part, at least, naive. There is one more theme, though, that has developed over the intervening years, the theme of sacrifice. The theme of you can't have it all, of sometimes you have to do what you're called upon to do rather than what you want to do. I think I first voiced this position in a commencement address at St. Burns Preparatory School in Pullman in May 2002. And there may be a little dragon lady in what I had to say to a group of expectant 18-year-olds at that time, but it was accepted, even appreciated. Parents asked for copies of the address, and it was published in the school's paper. I was gently debunking the commencement platitude that you can be anything you want to be, and I told them this. The cold water reality is that you may find some barriers to your desires that cannot be overcome. No matter how strong your will, no matter how deep your wisdom, no matter how burning your desire, the economy, fierce and unfair competition, family responsibilities may stand in your way. Some of you may even face subtle, unspoken discrimination because of your sex, the tone of your skin, or the accent of your speech. So maybe, just maybe, you cannot become anything you want to become. There are outside, uncontrollable, unavoidable forces that can, and sometimes will, impinge upon your academic, financial, and career success. There are, however, no contingencies external to you that can control your heart, your mind, and your spirit. Little could I realize in 2002 that I was talking about myself in 2010. I'll get back to that in a minute, and I'll linger around 2003 for a while. I have been serving as Associate Dean of the College with Neil Birdie and Irving Penfield, doing general education reform, and working on our 2004 SACS compliance report. And I was tired of it. On 3 December 2003, I sent an email to the faculty announcing my intention to resign that administrative position at the end of the academic year. I explained, my work with the honors program and first-year seminars over the past few years has reminded me of the joy and fulfillment I find in teaching and research. Consequently, after thoughtful consideration, I have decided to return to the classroom next year. You see behind me photos of me and students, all of whom I have delighted in, many of whom I have come to care for deeply, some of whom have become lifelong friends. They and the literature I love, they and the invitation for understanding something new about their lives or the lives of others that the literature offers are the reason I entered this profession in the first place. Seeing a tentative, recalcitrant, and even disengaged 18-year-old develop into an engaged, experienced person in becoming 4 years later is a tremendously gratifying thing. Therefore, I went back to where I started. In a November 2005 Provost Forum, Holy Grails, Gardens, and Professional Generations, I really like titles. For the subsequent sabbatical I had, I admittedly, with a touch of dragon's breath, had this to say about returning to the classroom. I have great respect and appreciation for my colleagues and enjoy working with them and for them. And I enjoyed the challenge of the work I was doing. But quite candidly, the challenges good students put before me are a little more nourishing to the soul. Also, I find that engaging with students enlivens me. Besides, I'm just happy in the classroom. By the fall of 2003, then, I had so much had my fill of articles on the delicate balance between student-faculty ratio and student units per faculty member, and the hurdles for women in higher education, that I longed for the clear-cut misogyny of the Middle Ages, which was more obsessed with the remission of sin than the remission of tuition dollars. So, I was teaching full-time again and directing the Harrison Honors Program, which enabled me to work with probably the most serious and ethnically diverse cohort of students on the campus. I was teaching first-year courses, medieval literature, Chaucer, interdisciplinary courses with medieval text and modern literary media adaptations. I had a nice office with windows on two sides, a magnificent black oak right outside the windows to the north. Life is good. But I should have begun to worry when the black oak died. I knew enough about the culture of the Middle Ages to have recognized a portent. I guess my focus at the time, though, was less on looking for omens in dead trees than on a second program of religious life, invited me to take part in, the If I Could Only Tell You One Thing lecture series. In March 2010, I presented, maybe I'm a medievalist because I did not want to be a missionary. In it, there was a rather self-satisfied retrospective of the 2003 decision to leave administrative work. Talking about how I made this decision, I explained, I had to engage in a period of discernment. Since that time, I've learned about a Lilly-funded program at Boston College that might have given more tidiness to the process. The program posits three questions to address. What gives you joy? What are you good at? Does anybody need you to do it? My focus was on the first of those questions. What gives you joy? In the case of higher education administration, the answer came easily. I was good at it, I believe. Moreover, it is a job that needs doing. But it did not give me joy. It gave me a sense of accomplishment, but not the kind of joy that for me feeds the soul. In the fall of 2003, I resigned my administrative position effective the end of that academic year. I am coming up on another sabbatical now, and my project will include working on various databases and on studying horticultural works of the Middle Ages and records of the actual medieval gardens in order to make better sense of literary gardens. I'd also like to improve my skill at digital photography and celebrate in my gardens the best I can. I never got that sabbatical. In the financial shortfall of 2010, it was called back. I was in Oxford that summer. I knew what was coming, or in the case of the sabbatical, I knew what wasn't coming. What I did not realize was that what that tell-it-like-it-is dragon lady told those fresh-faced 18-year-olds at St. Bernard's 8 years earlier was going to come back and bite her in her own tail. I was prevailed upon and agreed to serve as interim associate provost for the year. Having been named educator of the year in 2010, I gave the commencement address at BSC the following year. And I found myself echoing sentiments of 2002 to soon-to-be college graduates. Reflecting on their prospects and events of the previous year, I told them, the point is that great accomplishments are made possible when the world most needs what some individual is most capable and desirous of offering. So for those of you whose circumstances welcomes the gift you have to give, you will be able to do anything you want. For others, your talents may be oblique to the times. us, and it will be harder for you. For yet others, duty may trump desire, and you will, with I hope generosity of spirit, do what you must rather than what you want. 6 years later, my re-entry into administrative service as Interim Associate Provost will have as a bookend my exit as Interim Provost. Not what I intended. Not what I wanted. Following my own insistence on precision and language, I would not call this ironic, but it is certainly curiously coincidental. Admittedly, no one held a medieval or a college mace over my head and made me stay in academic affairs each of the last 6 years. It was my choice. Nonetheless, my choice was always based on what I was asked to do and what I thought I should do, rather than what I wanted to do. Nevertheless, the time has come for me truly to exit, to retire. Without rancor, bitterness, or sullenness, I acknowledge that the profession I entered when I began graduate school is changing, or more accurately, has changed. I first expressed notice of that change in the 1997 sabbatical presentation, after 40 years of it, you give separate presentations, so I'm going to keep going. Sabbatical presentation, 1997. Its title was Medieval Mystics, Multimedia, Mid-Career Musicals. It wasn't wasted. Wasn't wasted referred to the split nature of the sabbatical. Part of it was rather traditional literary scholarship, and part of it, at the time, a rather non-traditional construction of photographic databases of medieval cathedrals and cities. The presentation itself moved from academic voice to a self-reflected commentary on changing pedagogy. After a section of rather high academic rhetoric on Julian of Norwich's 14th century Middle English Revelations of Divine Love, there is this. Oh, the rhetoric. My rhetoric. My voice. I've known that voice for over 30 years. The love of parallel structure, alliteration, modification, coordination, subordination, education, manipulation, domination, fascination, publication. Yes, justified by publication. The voice in print, not the voice in the classroom. Except on rare occasion. There was a lecture on Boethius once, but the voice in the classroom has changed. It does not sound as much. It does not sound as definitively. As old as Socrates, as new as sitting in a circle. Intellectual midwifery made cozy. Student-centered, student-empowered, student-led, they begin class where I wanted to end. No longer the deliverers of dicta. We've become the tour guides through the maze. But the maze, day by day, gets more cluttered with tools. Tools to navigate our way through the twists and turns of information. Tools to see periscope light over the walls. Tools to let us see through the walls. What though if we had been leading students through the maze for years quite well, thank you. We used a compass to check our heading. Kept careful logbook for the next time through. And just in case we passed this way again, marked the walls with chalk to know that we had been here before. Somebody, though, has moved the walls around. They are now modular units with multi-purpose configurations. Somebody is altered. The maze is so much bigger. Somebody is always adding another room. And the students are showing up expecting more than logbooks and chalk. We either learn to use the tools or lose the students. They know they will have to be able to use them in the future. And if we do not teach them, it will go to someone else who can. 20 years after that 1997 presentation, the professor is still changing. Today I don't lecture so much as facilitate. I don't teach so much as serve as ringmaster to draw students' attention and direct their gaze. But this is not the reason it's time for me to exit. It is not how we teach that lets me know the time has come. What wearies and disheartens me is why people think we teach or should teach. When I first entered the professorship, if you asked students why they wanted a college education, the answer was generally to become well-rounded. Due to my insistence that words have meanings, this phase always brought to mind the image of bands of ball-shaped students rolling over campuses or being packed into classrooms like tomatoes in a cardboard box. What it actually meant, though, was a certain openness to learning a lot of things about a lot of disciplines so that they could think in a lot of alternative ways about a lot of alternative issues. It meant learning for the sake of cultivating habits of mind for living successfully, for cultivating appreciation for the arts, for understanding what it might be to live their lives with assurance while still valuing how I live mine, for recognizing injustices and feeling the compulsion to address them. For, as Birmingham-Southern's mission states, learning to live lives of significance. Ask the question now, and the answer will likely be to get a job. Now, well-rounded students wanted jobs too. And I have no issue with young women and men seeking an education to be successful in a career. We all benefit when our workforce is competent and creative. And there is no doubt that we can live lives of significance through our careers. I hope I have. What I object to is the accompanying social and assumed human value that has come to be the setting for that goal. It is the ascendancy of career over community, private over public. It is the necessity for higher education now to serve the human community and the public good through the back door of promised personal success. In thinking about this growing assumption that higher education is to prepare for students for jobs rather than for exercising decisions of justice, I went back to a work that was instrumental in forming my adult worldview over 40 years ago, Hannah Arendt's The Human Condition. Although published in 1958, I believe it remains one of the most significant books on political philosophy published in the 20th century. Drawing distinctions between private and public, labor and work, action and contemplation, immortality and eternity, rhetoric and dialectic, she argues that the truly private life deprives one of things essential to the truly human life. It deprives one of being seen and heard by others, of entering into, in her words, relationship with them that comes from being related to and separated from them through the intermediary of a common world of things. The private person, she argues, lives in the absence of others. And as far as others know, that person does not have presence in the public sphere, and therefore, in effect, does not exist. The truly private person remains without significance and consequence to others. Higher education, I sometimes fear, is on the cusp of fostering private interests over public good to the extent that an emphasis on future income and acquisition fosters erasure of presence in the communal interest of others. Now, I'm not saying that we should not be concerned with preparing students for work and career. If we do not, we may well foster our own erasure. Students and their parents want an education, that would provide them with transferable skills, applicable experience, essential networking, as well as essential knowledge. What I'm saying is that we should never mistake that need for our essential reason for being. There is no guarantee that career preparation is anything like cultivating an inclination to living a life of significance. Focused on private benefit, it could lead to non-existence in the deprivation of the public good. Failure to recognize this leaves us teetering on the edge of a fundamental misunderstanding of the human condition. In regard to undergraduate liberal education, we must never assume that because we must be conscious of career preparation, and we must, career preparation is not why we do and should exist. We must never mistake current conditions for undergraduate recruiting and outcomes for quintessential conditions of liberal arts and sciences education. In delineating the human condition, Aron explains, whatever touches or enters into sustained relationship with human life immediately assumes the character of a condition of human existence. The things that owe their existence exclusively to us, she argues, nevertheless consistently condition their human maker. What we have made continually remakes us. We can trap ourselves into accepting what is as what naturally is or should be. As a society, we can change what is. We can change, we have changed it over the past four decades. We can foster competence and compassion. We can prepare young men and women for lives of work and lives of significance. Birmingham-Southern College does it. We are one of the colleges that changed lives. But it requires vigilance and energy and creativity and resilience. It is time for me to exit and leave a space for new visions and new voices to carry the college over the bridge to the future. In that essential value of literature. I think, however, that I'm going to go back to my first class lecture and boldness and begin to act on an acceptance of something the constellation of philosophy taught me many, many years ago. Lady philosophy teaches Boethius about the inscrutable nature of God by saying that things are known by the capacity of the knower, and not by the capacity of the thing known. In other words, we can understand God to the extent that we can understand, but God can surpass that without us ever knowing, without us ever understanding. There are things that I simply cannot make sense of. I can't. This existence, creation, and the divine are just bigger than I. Bigger, grander, more mysterious than my capacity to know. I cannot make sense either of how or why I exist. Therefore, I'm going to switch focus a little and follow the direction of the former Archbishop of Canterbury, Rowan Williams. writing about the ultimate importance of human experience in the wound of knowledge, he cautions that Christians, and I would venture that those of other faiths as well, too often escape into transcendence rather than acknowledging that human change and growth takes place in every area of human existence, public and social, in the moral and the relational world. He concludes then that the goal of Christian life becomes not enlightenment, but wholeness, an acceptance of this complicated and muddled bundle of experiences as a possible theater for God's creative work. So, what will I do in retirement? I want to focus on becoming whole, on developing interests that have been placed to the side or given only limited attention for many years, to engage with this complicated and muddled bundle of experiences as a possible theater for my creative work. Hopefully, I will also return to some of what I had planned to do in that 2010 sabbatical. I will definitely pursue my interest in gardens, but likely my study will be much more in them than about them. Unquestionably, gardening has been a sanity saver for me over the past several years. I received my Master Gardener certification in 2005. And I want to spend more time in the garden, planting, pruning, trimming, replanting, negotiating with nature, who always wins, and creating, to the best of my ability, beauty. One of my favorite golden poems as a child was about playing in the mud. I made my mother read it to me over and over and over again. I'm happy that I still have that book. Mud is very nice to feel, all squishing out between the toes. I'd rather squish around in mud than smell a yellow rose. Nobody but the rose bush knows how nice mud feels between the toes. I now call it soil. But I still like playing in the dirt. I am happy there. As I planned, about 7 years ago, I want to become a better photographer of plants. I'm fascinated with the ways in which light plays off of delicate petals. How it can make them translucent.
Century French theologian and poet.
omnes mundi creatorum, quasi liber et pictorum, nobis est et speculum. All the created world is like a book, a picture, a mirror for us. Being a word person, I wanted verbal images to complement my visual images. In response, this past summer, I began writing poetry again. I wanted the verbal image to be tight, as clean and clear as the visual image. I wanted them to be compact little gems of picture and perception. Haiku, I thought. How naive I was. How hard a form. But I learned a tremendous amount in the attempt. Here's where I start. The original picture had many more bees in it, all of them rather drunk on fermenting pear juice. They really weren't drunk. I cropped rather closely for this image. The poem is the point, though. There are a couple of things wrong with the first version. On a rotting shard of pear, five bees feasting. Once I craved your love. Beside the syllable count being off, there's an enjambed line. Line should be able to stand alone. The second one was better. The count was better, but it's too static. Four hungry bees feast, rotting shards of little pear, love among the worlds. Alright, the third one is where it is at the moment. Rotting shards of pear, four ravenous bees feast, love among the worlds. I think I need to get rid of love. So I think that's the problem. I'm not done yet with this. But who would have thought that three lines and 17 syllables could be so amazingly difficult? Now these, I think, hold prompts. Rain on lake water, multiflorous concentric circles, targets. There's something a little Alabama about that, but I haven't quite decided what it is. Rain song on tin roof, coffee press steam, and two cups. One alone is filled. This one I think is really close. Fall slips in softly. Cicada sing counterpoint. Unsure transition. In some way, though, these are closer to images poems of the early 20th century than they are to haiku. This one, though, made publication in Haiku Journal. And I am as pleased with the publication of these 12 words as I have been with 20-page articles. Petals snow drifting, cherry paint swirling carpet. At your touch. There were other images and events of the summer that pushed me on to longer, harder poems. I knew, though, that if I was really going to claim what I was writing as poetry instead of verse, somebody else needed to see these works. Somebody needed to critique them. So I gathered my courage. And I showed some of them to my dear friend, Sandra Sprayberry, whose poetry I have great respect for. And she proved a gentle and wise mentor. One of those poems, reworked after her comments, found a parallel in Jim Neal's moving work, The Constant. Again, with some courage, I sent it to him. When Jim asked to include it in the guide for his exhibit, I knew that he and I shared equally visceral abhorrence of war. I also knew that I had written a poem. The Modern Family. Ferguson. Brussels. Olympia. Shrill sirens and souls scream their supplications for quiet and rest. Shards of glass, reflect 1,000 relentless suns among bent reborn and shattered concrete. Infernal gases creep into every crevice of creation. Stones crumble, rocks cascade. Impossibly fluorescent lava seeps through rocks like blood through a jagged wound. The world is broken. When they die, the parents go directly to heaven. Maybe it was war. Maybe it was some other memory that pulled up an image from the mid-70s, a time when I and all of my generation were dealing with the afterlife of Vietnam. Evening in the fall. His thumb and forefinger pinched the joint just rolled, burning it toward the palm. Warrior face of a helicopter navigator, defoliation, machine gun strafing. His thumb along the wooden spoon shaft held upside down, fingers wrapped loosely around the handle. Warrior face, concentration, jaw intense, stirring tonight's dinner. His thumbs traced my cheekbones, moved to eyebrows, lips, and jawline. Our children, he says, would have such noble profiles. His hands caress my shoulders, span my back, all but encircle my waist, command my hips. I remember his hands. I lost many plants in this fall 60-day drought. It was painful watching a rhododendron that bloomed for only the second time in 20 years this summer turned into desiccated brown sticks. Drought and desiccation, however, can come in many different ways. The next poem came a little more than halfway through the fall. The reference to 41 days instead of 60 days is the result of a medievalist affinity for ironic biblical references and obtuse numerology. It has been 41 days without rain. A mild night. Ceramic candle holder with cutout stars throws celestial patterns on the deck. Cars cracked pepper water crackers. Monterey pepper jack. Vodka straight from the freezer to feel the burn at the back of the throat to know the spirits are within you. And a glass from Venice. Blue, green, and red floating. Head back. One moves away. Is it a bird? A plane? Superman? The planets are brown stars. Another star moves away. Is it a bird? A plane? Or just a pattern of light? Recovery, the next, is the most recent piece I've written. In fact, it is the first thing since this fall. It's my image for weathering the storm, for weathering the spring. Recovery. A dry storm gathers showers of heat, melting sand in uneven arcs, like a frenzied seed simmer. Middling grass bends deep, seed heads in undulating bird flight, stuck to earth on buff brown stalks. Unbending comes uneasy. Battered seed heads sway lighter. Sand sticks in torn stems. Glass glistening spoils of victory. The final poem, number 6. I didn't count any of those haiku process. One poem's count. This is a response to something that has actually happened. In fact, it's actually happened several times. A box of my mother's scarves leaps off a shelf in my closet from time to time. Nothing else falls, just this box. garden. Once it happened during a time when I was reading quite a bit from the works of Irish poet Joan McBreen. Her carefully crafted poems of narrative remembrance had captivated me. The result was Colors from the Book of Kells. The Book of Kells is a late 8th, early 9th century richly illuminated gospel codex in the library of Trinity College in Dublin. Colors from the Book of Kells. The shoebox full of your scars fell from the shelf again today. Oblong and square, gifts I brought from Dublin, Paris, London, to wear with your blue jacket. Red, gold, and purple, bright colors of your garden, I see you there in the colors of the Book of Kells. Does it matter which scarf falls farthest from the box?
Matter, she asked herself, to
picking up her brush again. She looked at the steps, they were empty. She looked at her canvas, it was blurry. With a sudden intensity, as if she saw it clearer for a second, she drew a line there in the center. It was done. It was finished. Yes, she thought, lying down her brush in extreme fatigue. I have had my vision. Shante. Shalom.
Thank you.